welcome, and you might want to have the bulletin, which is at presbyws.org/worship. And feel free to chat. We wish a very warm welcome to our guest preacher, the Reverend Grayson Van Camp, who until recently served as a parish associate here at the Presbyterian Church of Western Springs. So it's really welcome back. She's currently the Presbytery of Chicago's ecumenical representative on ecumenism, Metro Chicago, and Chicagoland Christians United for Care of Creation. She's an alum of McCormick Theological Seminary and served there for a decade as the Director of Continuing Education and Alumni Relations, and served the Presbytery of Chicago for 3 years as an interim associate executive presbyter. She holds the distinction of being the first Anglo woman ordained to serve as a Korean American congregation, Ham Nee Presbyterian Church in Itasca, where she was called as an associate pastor and pastor of English ministries. We have a weekly connection email to keep you informed about things going on, including prayer requests, birthdays, and other news. This week's it's all about mission here at PCWS from your mission team. It highlights this year's big project, Refugee One, and today is all about mission. Stop by the Jones Room following worship today and join us in this month's pop-up mission project. That's PUMP for short. We are making laundry kits for the clients of the Beds Plus Care program. This program helps vulnerable individuals stabilize their lives through housing and supportive services. These kits provide the clients with supplies for doing their laundry. And through making these kits, we're able to help a person in need and strengthen our community. There's a special opportunity today for families to volunteer at Feed My Starving Children today. This is from 2 to 3:45 at their Schomburg location. Stacia Ferrer is arranging all of that. There's always a need at the Second Baptist Church of LaGrange Food Pantry. Now there is a need for rice and canned vegetables, so just drop them off here at the church. And please reach out to Terry for any information you want included in the weekly connection. The fellowship pads in the inner aisle, please take them. Let us know you're here. It enables us to learn who's worshiping in your pew. And if you're new here, please include your mailing address and or email. This morning is Fellowship Sunday, and you're invited to stay after worship, that is after pumping, that is, and join us for fellowship on the patio. Thank you to our hosts this morning. Quick update on the interim pastor nominating committee. If you're here last week, you may recall Paul Pressman. I've been told we look alike, but I frankly don't see the resemblance. But he did mention the passing along of our ministry information form, and that's underway, and it keeps us in the networking realm and to seek candidates from as many avenues as possible, in addition to the national system. Special thank you to our musicians this morning, John and John Leslie and Stephanie. As we transition from a time of gathering to our time of worship, I want to remind you there are baskets in the back of the church. You can place your offering, or you can donate online, of course. We dedicate the gifts and offerings of God to God's glory and work in and through this congregation and in the world. John.
So if you're looking in the bulletin and you see that I'm going to sing a duet with my dad, you're thinking, well, that's going to be a trick. When my dad retired in 1985, I had this brainiac idea. I was going to go to his house and I was going to do an interview with him. So I took my little cassette recorder and I went there to ask about his time in the big bands in the 30s and the 40s and in the 50s up until the time he got polio, and then his 30 years as a Chicago society musician after that. So in 1985, I went there, little cassette recorder, didn't have much of a plan. It was pretty choppy until he started doing, which is what my dad did, is he just started playing songs off his head. And at some point, after 5 or 6 Jerome Kern songs in a row, he just kind of sits up and he blurts out, there's no hymn though, he just goes, favorite hymn? So I digitized the cassette, I clipped it, and this is that moment from 37 years ago.
John. Please join me in today's call to worship. Please stand if you're able. Come, let us praise the Lord together. All the hosts of heaven, all you shining stars, mountains and all hills, wild animals and flying birds, for he commanded and you were created. Rulers of the earth and all peoples, young men and women, old and young, let us praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted, and he delights in his people, crowning them with honor and glory. Praise the Lord.
Sisters, before God and one another, let us quiet our hearts and confess the excuses that we have made for not living as we have been commanded to live. First, let us pray silently and then together responsively. for our blindness to the needs of others and our preoccupation with our own needs and wants. Lord, have mercy. For our failure to pay attention to the still small voice in our lives, for our surrender to fear and self-protection. Lord, have mercy. For believing that we are somehow better than our neighbors, for neglecting to see Jesus in others. Lord, have mercy. For our wanton misuse of your creation and our willful ignorance about ways we personally contribute to it. Lord, have mercy. For the casual way we claim the title Christian, for the thoughtless word, the hasty judgment, the silence in the face of injustice. Lord, have mercy. For all our life choices this week that have not contributed to greater love and justice in the world, Lord, have mercy. Forgive us. Help us to truly repent and to live lives worthy of your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Listen to what God says. I have taken away the judgments against you. I will remove disaster from you so that you will not bear reproach for it. O Lord, you are our strength and our might. You have become our salvation. Amen. Cleansed from our sins, let us greet one another in the name of our Lord and Savior. The peace of Christ be with you.
Tell me what's inside the box. A game? No, the box is the game. Inside of it is a piece of the game. Okay, I didn't expect you to get it first try. I didn't expect you to get it, so we're gonna make it a little bit easier. What's inside the box? A game board? No, not quite. I also didn't expect you to get it with this. Okay, who thinks they're really good at touching things? Okay. Here, I'm gonna make a crack in the box. Don't look inside the box, but stick your hand in and see if you can feel what's in there. Can you feel something? Well, there's some of that in there, but there's something also in there that got pushed to the bottom. Here, feel this, go look at it. Right back there. Can you tell me what's in it other than the packing material? You still don't feel it? Okay, let me give you one more hint. Here, you pull your arm out and I'll try and help. One more hint. What if I pull it out? What is this? It's a cup. Is that kind of not exciting? It's just a mug that I found in the kitchen. But let me ask you this. How did you find out finally that it's a mug? Because you couldn't tell me what it was when it was in here. But what happened? What changed between when it was in here and when you... What do you do with your eyes? See it. You see it. If you can just yell out things at me, that's fine. So you saw it. Do you know what sight is? What do we call it? We call it a sense. What do we do with sight? What does it help do? We see things. Exactly. So we have senses. There's all kinds of senses. We engaged the sense of hearing when I shook it around, but it still didn't tell you what you needed to do. We tried the sense of touch, but the box was too big and you couldn't even find it. But then finally the sight of seeing, the sense of sight is what told you what it is. So today, all the grown-up children are gonna learn a little bit more about a different sense that I think God's given us. And it's the sense of knowing who is following in the way of God and its love. Has anyone ever done anything to you that just made you feel so loved? What's something? Yes? A hug. Yes. What else? Nothing else that was loving. A kiss. Yes. There's physical love. Did anyone do something kind for you? Did that feel loving? Yeah. So we're going to learn more about what it means to follow Jesus and to love the people around us. That's my story today. Thanks for coming and hanging out with me. Let's lead the Lord's Prayer, okay? Can you do that with me? Okay. All y'all are going to help me because I'm a new Presbyterian. So let us say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive those. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
All right, now you can go do your Sunday school stuff, and I'm going to take my box back with me.
Chapter 13, verses 31 to 35. It's on page 102 of your Pew Bible if you want to follow along. Let's listen to John's account of Jesus' Last Supper with his disciples. When he here is Judas, when he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Oh my, when I heard John practicing that earlier this morning, I told him, I know that that is going to go through my mind all week, and I think that's a good thing. Thank you so much. Love one another. What's love got to do with it? I saw a short program about Tina Turner about a week ago, and I'm happy to report that she's alive and well and happy and living in Switzerland. But if you're anything like me, when you hear the phrase, what's love got to do with it, you immediately think about her 1984 song, what's love got to do with it. What's love but a sweet old-fashioned notion, a secondhand emotion? What's love got to do with it? Who needs a heart when a heart can be broken? It was especially poignant to hear her sing those lyrics because by the time she did so, we, the public, knew the turmoil the ugliness and the violence that had existed in her marriage to Ike Turner. And although that marriage ended in 1978, it was obvious that it took her decades to work through some painful memories. What's love got to do with it? If we were ever asked on a TV game show to name the qualities of love, most of us here and those streaming the service online could tick off many, if not all, of the qualities of love because we've heard them listed over and over again in 1 Corinthians 13. Love is patient and kind, not envious, boastful, arrogant, or rude. It doesn't insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. It doesn't rejoice in wrongdoing. It rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. Those verses are often used in wedding ceremonies because this kind of love is the most difficult type, the type of love Jesus spoke about. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. The Greeks have helped our understanding of love by defining four types of love: philios, a strong liking, a strong deep friendship; storge, which is the love that exists between parents and children, often between siblings, and can exist in a good marriage; eros, sexual passionate love; and agape, the love that is the very nature of God. Agape love is not a feeling, it's an action. About 20 years ago, a book by the author Gary Smalley called Love as a Decision was in vogue for Presbyterian study groups. You may have studied it. Smalley died in 2016, but I believe his book was a real blessing to the church because he had it right. Love is a decision. It's not just some warm, fuzzy feeling or the desire to do good. Agape love always asks, are you willing to do things for my sake that you do not want to do? Loving is difficult. It's no wonder Jesus had to spell it out for us many times. John recorded him saying it even one more time in the 15th chapter. Love others in the same way I have loved you. Is that clear enough? Do you get it? Jesus might have said. If you and I dare to claim the title Christian, then love has everything to do with us, everything to do with the church. Which brings us to what's happening now in America. Any of us who pay attention to the news or surf the internet or spend time on social media know that currently the church is in the news and not in a good way. Let's face it, we've always had our detractors. The church is an easy target and people have long memories. But we don't need to go back to the Crusades to be criticized. Today's news is enough to make us wince in shame and disgust. Clergy misconduct, clergy abuse of children, discrimination against women, indigenous children taken by churches and the government and abused and buried in unmarked graves. The shocking audacity of riches of some megachurches and their pastors. And the list goes on and on. William Willimon, who happens to turn 75 years old just today, knows the mainline church very well. He's a retired United Methodist bishop. He's still professor of the practice of Christian ministry at Duke University. In a passage about the church as the bride of Christ, Willimon writes, "Jesus has many admirers who feel he married beneath his station." The church has failed to live up to her great commission in so many ways, large and small. Beloved author C.S. Lewis, in his insightful little book, The Screwtape Letters, describes the devil's delight that the church is one of his best allies in the battle for the souls of new converts. And a tiny little example in my own life to prove that I can be one of those problems. I was worshiping in our son's church recently, and a family sat behind us in the pew, and they spoke loudly through the whole service to their little children, and it took everything in me not to turn around and shush them. Me, a pastor who wants people to come to the church. Thankfully, I managed to control myself, but I recognize I'm part of the problem. I am part of the problem that is the church. But recently, the church is in the news in a whole new troublesome way. Just yesterday, the New York Times published an article by Maureen Dowd entitled, "Too Much Church in the State." Dowd, a Roman Catholic herself, is concerned about the makeup of the Supreme Court. She writes, "There is an astonishing preponderance of Catholics on the Supreme Court. 6 out of the 9 justices and a 7th, Neil Gorsuch, was raised as a Catholic and went to the same Jesuit boys' high school in a Maryland suburb that Brett Kavanaugh and my nephew did." She continues, "Last year at Thomas Aquinas College in California, Justice Samuel Alito fretted that there's a growing cultural hostility towards Christianity and Catholicism. There's a real movement," he said, "to suppress the expression of anything that opposes the secular orthodoxy." But is it his job, or the job of the justices, to suppress the will of others to protect their narrow view of orthodoxy? If the society doesn't respect religion, Alito has also said, religious liberty becomes imperiled. But I worry about religion. Nothing in what we have heard or read sounds very Christian to the non-believer. There are no words of comfort or compassion for women who are carrying the result of rape or incest. No loving sympathy or solace for those with horrendously dangerous medical condition or fetuses that simply cannot survive. I worry for the church if the liberty of non-religious people or religious people with differing beliefs is imperiled or abridged because of a minority religious viewpoint. We may be teetering on a brink here. Is it possible that the brand Christian will continue to be used as a weapon? Will it be degraded in the eyes of the nation and continue to suffer because some Christians have forgotten their primary directives? Douglas John Hall, former pastor and emeritus professor of theology at McGill, wrote something that should be a warning to us all. "The conversion of Constantine was the effective beginning of Christendom, namely, of that particular form of the Christian religion that consists of a strong alliance of Christianity with political and social power. Something amounting to the practical identification of Christianity with the dominant forces of the society in which it finds itself." Isn't this the kind of Christianity, the kind that's propping up Vladimir Putin's rebellion, as we see the Russian Orthodox Church supporting his every move? We must not let this brand of Christianity tarnish the Church of Jesus Christ here. Douglas John Hall also writes with the antidote to that form of false Christianity. The antidote is Jesus. Jesus saves. He saves us for life, forgiving ourselves over to its joys and sorrows, to predictable and unpredictable occurrences, its routines and surprises. Jesus saves us from the awful habit we have of trying to save ourselves, of sparing our energies, of protecting our minds and souls and bodies from the life struggle. Jesus saves us for the spendthriftiness of love. The spendthriftiness of love. I love that phrase. I've heard Jesus' words tossed back in our faces on network TV by people who are angry at what they fear is coming from the Supreme Court. One young black woman practically screamed at the camera, "I thought you Christians were all about loving one another. Well, if this is your idea of love, you can go to hell." As I watched that young woman's anguish, I wanted to speak with her. I wanted to put my arm around her and invite her to church, to this church, or any church as loving and caring as this one. And I wish I could do the same for all the naysayers I watch on the news and those who vilify Christianity on social media. At my ordination 30 years ago, Professor Don Wardlaw preached a sermon about the story that we know as the prodigal son. But he entitled it, "Tell Them About the Prodigal Father, Grayson." He stressed the spendthriftiness of love, the prodigal love that the father offered those two sons of his. They say that preachers often preach to themselves. They preach what they need to hear, and certainly in my case, I think that's true. I grew up in an Irish Catholic family, a family who disciplined with two well-worn tools, guilt and shame. Reminders of the angry, frowning God of the Old Testament were served up as regularly as meals. I grew up knowing that God was watching everything I did, listening to every conversation, checking every report card, every poorly done chore, and finding me wanting in it all. So it shouldn't be a surprise when I pull out random sermons from among the 900 or so I've preached that I find most of them have at their center an affirmation of the generous, overwhelming, undeserved, amazing, some might say wanton love of God. That's the love that we want to tell them about, isn't it? It was believing in God's unconditional love, God's amazing grace, that turned my life around and gave me my true identity. But the naysayers don't know, and the ones trying to judge, trying to demand, trying to have their way don't know either. They have no idea what real Christianity looks like. They haven't experienced church. They don't know you. You know, the other day I saw a lovely little video of turtles in a pond, and it made me cry because it made me think of the church. You probably see it at some point. There's one unfortunate little turtle struggling ferociously on its back, struggling in the midst of 20 or 30 other turtles who are swimming normally, minding their own business. But as this poor upside-down turtle struggles and struggles, suddenly all of the turtles, about 20 or 30 of them, start enclosing, getting closer and closer to the struggling one. And when they get very close to that one, he sort of gives up and he just gets calm. And together they flip him over, and then they all go there on their merry way. And I cried because I saw the church in the struggling turtle and all you wonderful helpers that flipped it over. Isn't that what we do as a church? For those around us and those we seek to aid, to be with them when they struggle, to lend aid without asking if they deserve it, without questioning how they got flipped wrong in the first place, to dare getting flipped over ourselves in the process of helping them. Michael Lindvall is the former pastor of Brick Presbyterian Church and First Presbyterian Church in Ann Arbor. But I know him best as the author of two little books I have about the adventures of a small-time pastor. I recommend them to you. The Good News from North Haven and Leaving North Haven. Lindvall is such a great storyteller that this small-town pastor has been invited to open the Scottish Parliament with a devotion a few times. And in 2017, he was asked to preach to Queen Elizabeth when she was at Balmoral Castle with the royal family. So you know he's good. His books are full of wonderful stories from his own experience in the pseudonym, however, of the Reverend David Battles. One story called Our Organist is about his experience of being a guest supply preacher for a tiny church in a fictional town called Carthage Lake, Minnesota. The little flock of 11 souls hadn't had a minister of its own since 1939. But one Sunday each month at noon, they gather to worship and listen attentively to whatever supply preacher they can get to drive out to their dwindling town. The clerk of the congregation, Lloyd Larson, assured the pastor of 100% attendance if he came, and he promised an organist, the same organist Carthage Lake had been promising guest preachers for 60 years, Lloyd's sister-in-law, Agnes Rigstad. The Sunday of his guest appearance arrived, and Reverend David Battles describes the small white-framed building, the large sentimental stained glass windows of Jesus the Good Shepherd, lamb in one arm, staff in the other, and Jesus praying alone in the Garden of Gethsemane, and the two cars and a pickup truck that he saw in the parking lot. There were actually 12 worshipers gathered, including a young man, scattered throughout this sanctuary, much as you are today. Lloyd explained that there was no bulletin, that the preacher should just announce the hymns. So David nodded to the organist, with her wig slightly askew, who responded with a broad, toothy smile. Worship began. Reverend Battles announced the opening hymn, number 204, Spirit of God, Descend Upon My Heart. He had taken a lot of time choosing these hymns. They went perfectly with the sermon. Agnes, the organist, smiled at him and played, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. The 11 elderly members sang it by memory. Only the young man reached for a hymnal. Following the sermon, David wondered if Agnes was hard of hearing, so he loudly announced the next hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. He looked directly at Agnes, who smiled back and played, I Love to Tell the Story. After the prayers and offering, he walked over to the organ bench, bent down and whispered, Agnes, what are we going to sing? And she smiled and began to play, Just As I Am, Without One Plea. After worship, Agnes shook his hand but didn't say a word. Lloyd sheepishly explained, I forgot to tell you about Agnes. You don't need to tell what hymn it's going to be, only when. Agnes only knows those three hymns, so we always sing them. Good grief, Lloyd. You mean to tell me you've been singing the same three hymns for 60 years? Lloyd was looking down then, concentrating on the frayed sanctuary carpet. Well, we like those hymns well enough, and we know them by heart, and she is our organist. Later, David met the young man, Neil Larson, who explained he was Lloyd's grandson. Agnes is my late grandmother's little sister, Lloyd's wife's baby sister, but she's never been quite right. She never says more than a few words. But she learned to play those hymns one week 60 years ago when the regular organist got sick. It was a moment of musical emergency around here. Anyway, she hasn't been able to learn anything else since. Playing the organ this one Sunday a month means the world to her. Sometimes I think it's mostly for her that they keep the church open. Aunt Agnes lives for the first Sunday of the month. This is what church is. Isn't this what we should be about? Showing love to one another, holding together as the varied forces of society and the rigors of time and age try to pull us apart? If I speak in the tongues of mortals and angels but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I give away all my possessions and if I hand over my body so that I may boast but do not have love, I gain nothing. The selfless, prodigal, wanton, agape love that God in Christ Jesus offers is our new commandment. It's the way we are to interact with one another and with all others. Thinking of others before ourselves doesn't come naturally. Jesus knew that. He told us again and again to love one another as we love ourselves, to love one another as he loved us. But then he showed us by his model in life, by his death for our sake. You and I know what selfless human behavior looks like. We've seen it expressed in the body of Christ right here. Right here and now, it is changing hearts and minds, changing lives. If only we could share that with the world, what a different place it might be. After that service in First Presbyterian Church of Carthage Lake, Neil Larson lingered on. Aunt Agnes lives for the first Sunday of the month, he said to David Battles. Sometimes I think it's mostly for her that they keep the church open. They asked me to play, of course, he went on. They had to ask, but Grandpa knew that I'd say no. I remember how he sighed with relief when I said no, and he slapped me on the back. You're an organist? The preacher asked. Eastman, class of 84. I've had some big church jobs, the last one down in Texas. Big church, brand new organ, 102 ranks, 4 services a Sunday. Then I got sick. I've been HIV positive for 6 years. The personnel committee of the church figured it out. The weight loss, all the sick days. The fact that I'm not married. They told me it would be best if I moved on, but not until after Christmas, of course. My parents live in St. Paul, but my father and I haven't spoken since I was 19. I'm not sick enough to go into the hospital, just too tired most of the time. I really had nowhere else to go. My grandfather said I could move in with him and Agnes, and to tell you the truth, I feel right at home in a town of 80-year-olds. He paused and went on. They keep Agnes, and they took me in. And since I moved here most every night, Lloyd or Old Man Engstrom from down the road opens a church for me. If it's cold, they lay a fire in the wood stove, and then I play the organ. It's a sweet little instrument, believe it or not. Lloyd has kept it up. These last weeks, it's been almost warm in the evenings, so they leave the doors and the windows of the church open, and everybody sits out on their front porches and listens to me play. Bach, Buxtehude, Vidor, all the stuff I love. And then they clap from their porches. Even Agnes claps. Jesus said, I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Now let us sing hymn number 301 as our prayer. Let us build a house where all are welcome. I couldn't hear you.
Faith and fault of grace, near the Lord.
Let us pray. Center us, Creator God, precious Jesus, Holy Spirit, as we stop to pray. Hear our prayers, both silent and spoken, as we pray for those near and far who need your care. Help us to have ears to listen and eyes to see in order to discern those among us who need loving care, and make us instruments of your love and grace. Continue to bless this church and your church throughout the world. Sustain her with your love, correct her when she fails, fill her with hope as she strives to obey the Great Commission. We pray for the world and for those nations where violence, greed, and tyranny cause enormous suffering. We pray for men, women, and children who are hungry, thirsty, for those who are homeless, and for those who have been driven from their homes by wars and violence. God of abundant love, we feel so helpless at times. So we also lift to you our fears, our needs. Fill us with hope. Help us to truly love one another. Empower us to feed your sheep. Especially now as we watch the carnage of the war in Ukraine, Lord, we pray for lives lost and hearts broken. We trust that all are safely in your embrace. We ask that the war might end, that peace might reign. We ask for comfort and peace for those in the struggle, and we lift to you those who have died, praying as our Orthodox brothers and sisters pray, may their memory be eternal. But Lord, we also pray that you stir us to action in their memory. Continue to challenge us to do all that is possible in our realm to promote peace and justice in the world, in our country, and in our neighborhoods. Help us to truly love our neighbors. God of life, remind us daily of your vision for this world, that as people of renewed faith and vitality, we may be empowered to serve you as you desire us to serve. And so give glory to you in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
With the saints by the river, the flow.
like Reverend Battles, I chose the hymn after the sermon very carefully and was pleased to hear it being played by our organist. So the charge, of course, is love one another. But I think this hymn also says it. Let us build a house where all are named, their songs and visions heard and loved, and treasured, taught, and claimed, as words within the word, built of tears and cries and laughter, prayers of faith and songs of grace. Let this house proclaim from floor to rafter, all are welcome in this place. Thanks be to God. And now, may the love of our Lord Jesus Christ, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.